Hello, welcome again. Today we will study yet another poem of Philip Larkin, and which is entitled The Wits and Weddings. What is so special about this poem that made Philip Larkin one of the very popularly known poets, and which is one of the three poems written on train journey by Philip Larkin? First, let's see what is the title about. Wits and Weddings has got the term Whitson in it, and this Whitson is a particular time, and most particularly Saturdays. Whitson Saturdays were certain days on which in a particular part of the year, largely summers, because summers in England are the best seasons, and even Shakespeare has written about shall I compare thee to a summer's day. So summers are the seasons of pleasantness, and in this season on Saturdays there is a kind of tax relaxation while one is going in to be married. So the government relaxes the taxes, and whenever there is a relaxation of the tax, we all want to do the things in those relaxed times. So weddings are being solemnized on a Whitsun Saturday. Following this day is a Sunday, and which would keep the wedded people in a state of happiness. So let's see the poem Wits and Weddings, written by Philip Larkin. That Whitson, I was late getting away. He begins by giving an authenticity to the narrative, and it was a Whitson Saturday. It is a particular Whitson Saturday on which he was late getting away. That means it is the late time of the day when he should have been in the habit of leaving early, but today on this particular Whitson day, Saturday, he is late. I was late getting away, The description begins. Not till about 1:20 on the sunlit Saturday did my 3/4 empty train pull out. All windows down, all cushions hot, all sense of being in a hurry gone. He begins the narrative by saying that there is no hurrying. He's late because it's a Saturday and it's a weekday, and he would be having a Sunday follow. So it was the train started at 1:20 on a sunlit Saturday. It was a very bright and a sunny day, and the train was 3/4 empty when it pulled out of the station. All windows were down, all cushions hot, and all sense of being in a hurry gone. The repetition of the word all speaks volumes of the keen observation of the poet. He says that everything seems to be very comfy. Windows are down and cushions are hot and no one is in a hurry. He continues, we ran behind the backs of houses, crossed a street of blinding windscreens, smelt the fish dock. Thence the river's level drifting breath began, where sky and Lincolnshire and water meet. So the train is running behind the backs of houses. This lends a very picturesque quality to the narrative of this journey that he describes of having happened on a Whitsun Saturday. So they are running behind the backs of houses, because houses are never made. You know, this introduces to a special thing which we might not have noticed, that houses are never made facing the railway tracks, because the noise coming out from the trains might deafen the people with a longer exposure to this rattling and noise, rattling sound. So they ran behind the backs of houses. No one was watching them. It was a happy journey. They crossed a street of blinding windscreens. So there were windscreens. The windows of the houses could be seen. And then came the smell of the fish dock. So they came to a river where people were busy catching fish. And then the river's level drifting breath began. And because the river was not in rage, it was a calm river, it was a calm state where fish could be caught easily. Remember this, keep note of this, fish are being caught unawares. The river is in a state which is allowing for the catching of fish. And it's a big drifting breath. The river is a broad one. And with this broad river in view, the sky and Lincolnshire and water meet. This present indefinite word, meet, speaks about the general state of affairs, the regular state of affairs, that in this part of the town, it is the sky, the earth and the water meeting. This is an image as if of a rounded up image that comes from the sky and meets the water. And in between is this Lincolnshire from where they have left for London. Now in this stanza, we see, we must try to learn, if at all we are to write down a narrative of a journey, how largely we can make it authentic. We speak about the day on which the incident happened. We speak about the state of being of things. And we talk about anything that we see on our way. So the first stanza is an introductory one in which he launches you straight into that journey which began on a sunlit Saturday in a nearly three quarters empty train, with everything comfortable and with the landscape making witness across the window panes, and which the poet is keenly observing. All afternoon through the tall heat that slept for miles inland, though not used with a bold letter, but the heat has been personified as a monster that stretched for miles inland. All afternoon, again that all comes, the keen observation. He has been keeping track of the time. It was the whole afternoon from after 1:20 onwards. And a big place, everything seemed to be comforted with heat. A slow and stopping curve southwards we kept. So the journey is moving southwards. They are journeying southwards, and south has got various annotations. The place of warmth, but the place of sin as well. Wide farms went by, short shadowed cattle. See, this again, his keen eye for observation, because the sun was overhead, therefore the cattle were casting only very small shadows beneath them. And canals with floatings of industrial froth. The 20th century world. The lifelines which ought to stay clean are fraught with industrial froth. Again, a dirty picture of this journey that is moving, that is being undertaken towards south. So that sin, the dirt, industrial froth is floating on the canals. A hothouse flashed uniquely. Hothouse, a place where the harvested corn is kept. So there were hothouses. Now, hedges dipped and rose. See, you know, he is so intently looking outside the window that he sees the hedges dipping and rising. So you see, it's not a static or a linear journey. His eye is capturing everything that is outside and is giving dimension to the picture that he has presented of the journey. Hedges dipped and rose, and now and then a smell of grass displaced the reek of buttoned carriage cloth until the next town. So the carriage cloth, the curtains that are on the windows of the train, they were stinking. The reek, the stink of that, due to long abuse, I should say, they are not clean. And this reek is sometimes displaced by a smell of grass. Some fresh breath comes in until the next town. And then they moved into the next town after Lincolnshire, which is new and nondescript. He might not have been able to read the name of the place, so he says it's a nondescript. That means villages, you know, they do not hold any kind of differentiation each from the other, because each seemed to be a nondescript one. All had their farms, all had their hothouses, and all had some kind of stream or a canal running outside them. So, they were all new and nondescript and approached with acres of dismantled cars. So, there were acres of land in which dismantled cars. This is the picture of the modern world. Witnessing not only the natural forces of the sky, of the earth, of the waters as having been stained with dirt, the inside of the train with the carriage cloth which is dirty, but outside also lies the remains of this industrial world. Cars are the symbols of motion, the symbols of progress, and also now with long use they have been dumped here. So it must have been a place where these dismantled cars would be brought to a recycling reconstruction maybe. So it was a big land, many acres of land were sprawled with these dismantled cars. So that this stanza tells you that when they head southwards, they see cattle, but they also see industrial froth. They see the hothouse. They smell the grass. He smells the grass. And he then realizes when the fresh gush of breeze comes in, he realizes that this smell of grass has replaced the reeking, the rotten, the smell of staleness that was there in the carriage cloth. Only when something substitutes do we realize the presence of the other. So this stanza is about the keen observation which he, as a traveler journeying through to London, makes an assessment of this journey on a Whitsun Saturday. If you were asked to write down a narrative of a train, of a journey by train, would you have cared to write down these details? We generally, if we are given to write, we always write down that we entered in and then there was a big crowd inside and everything was dirty or maybe clean, and then we fell into conversation with the people. But we lose that sight for what is there outside the train. This probably could be for the reason that it was 3/4 empty. The train was 3/4 empty and there was no one to converse with. The poet seemed to have been lost or given in to himself only, and in this moment of not having someone to converse with, he just gives you an account of what was inside, but largely of what was outside the train. There was nothing that was catching his attention in the train, so everything that caught his attention outside the train he has presented for us. And we'll continue in this beautiful journey with Philip Larkin in the next lecture. Thank you.